Hey, thank you for tuning in. Here we are down in Hartford, Connecticut, and I'm with Wayne Coste with the Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth at a symposium. And what I would like to ask first off for our viewers, and that is, what brings you here? And could you tell us a little about the Architects and Engineers?
Oh, sure. Well, I'm here because there's an event coming on going on that's talking about 9/11. I've been very involved in Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. I'm a registered professional engineer, and what I usually say is I believe the laws of physics apply every day, and I think you do too, right?
They seem to, even in space.
Yeah, and so there's a number of reasons why I have gotten involved in Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth, and the first is that I believe I've been a witness to a mass murder of at least 300 firefighters and first responders who were in a building that should not have collapsed, but in fact was utterly destroyed. So that's one of the reasons. Secondly, I'm an engineer. And as I said before, I believe the laws of physics apply every day. Because we have created, because out in the world is a story that this building destruction was as a result of a gravitational collapse. One of the problems with that, of course, is that it denies physics. And one of the things that we want to do here in our country is to promote physics and engineering because it's an important science and works on our competitiveness. And as a result of denying it, you're discrediting the entire branch. What you've seen isn't what really happened. And so it's a real shock for me as an engineer to see this being downplayed as something important. You see it, it didn't happen this way, you can't explain it. Thirdly, there's a deeper story here that goes far beyond what we've been told. And one of the takeaway messages is you have to pay attention. There's a lot of things that you have to read and understand to know where this came from. And so that's one of the reasons I do this to partly to figure out where how do you tell people what to look for in history. And thirdly, there's a very villainized community in this world, in this country, called the Muslim.
Demonization of individuals or groups, yes.
Individuals, especially the Muslim community. And if you remember the Ground Zero discussions, mosque discussion earlier, you know that Muslims have been severely targeted. And in fact, the story is really much deeper. And so those are kind of the four reasons I give for being here and being involved with Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth to try to promote an understanding of what really happened that day and to get people motivated to find out some more.
Excellent. My view is I try to bring to them what little experience I have, and that was for a while I worked in the defense industry, actually blowing things up and shooting them down,
yep.
And had been a part to many of our weapon systems testing, and actually, you know, documenting those tests at thousands of frames per second. And when the day happened, something just wasn't right with me. And the more and more I investigated, especially when I look at the buildings and the building collapses, well, at the end of every show, by the way, if the viewers watch the credits, they'll see Building 7 collapsing, because I put it on at the end of every show, right. And I ask people to watch it. What I was going to say was, an architect, even for the buildings that were struck by planes, knowing that Building 7 wasn't, but for the two buildings that were struck by planes, their base and foundations held them up during the strike and after the strike. And we're led to believe by someone that you know, that the structure that was, you know, controlling or holding that load for all that time, that it just decided to become feeble and made, you know, it instantly became brittle or something. The thing that I saw too is with my own experience is the ability to create powder out of concrete. I had customers in World Trade, and I had been on many floors in World Trade, and many of the floors in World Trade were empty. At least when I went there, and I was going there through the 80s and into the 90s. And so there's a lot of empty space there, but to create that powder out of that concrete in collapse form to say, wow, and let alone ejecting the material out, while I'm told that what, the base had to go too, because the base was supporting these structures. I remember the structures, and like I said, being a person in them, you're right up to, I want to say you'd have to switch the elevator 2-3 times because the elevators, there's a distance length on that. But as an architect, once again, how did they try to tell the people that, well, gee, the foundations gave way? You know, when you look at the rubble, you're like, oh my gosh, how many floors did I supposedly lose and how?
Right. Well, there's, of course, a discussion about how the buildings collapsed. And the official story is that The top of the tower became unstable as a result of heat and started the downward descent. At time equal to zero, though, it's not moving at all and should have just, if there was weaknesses, it should have just tipped over and fallen over. And if you take a look at the South Tower, that's when I first saw it happen live on television without knowing what was going to happen, I saw that the top of the tower started to lean, and I said, oh my God, it looks like we're going to have an 80-story tower. And as a result of its tipping and the rotational inertia, the top of the tower should just continue going over. But instead, it went all the way down, floor, all the way down. And I just couldn't believe what I had seen.
While at the same time turning into dust.
Well, you know, I couldn't see that. All I could see is a cloud of dust. When I looked, there was nothing left. And I just couldn't fathom that at all. And I was bothered by it. And then when the second one happened, how did this happen? And I waited for, and I bought the official story, a fire-induced collapse, because...
it's being trumpeted by everyone. That's the song that they're singing.
That's right. And so it took me, I was really uncomfortable. People kept saying, oh, the story's, I kept hearing people saying that there's another side of the story. And I kept being resistant. I said, I'll wait till the official story comes out. And then when the official story, basically, as I heard it come out, it didn't sound like anything that was remotely usable or helpful from an engineering point of view to understand what happened. And then about 2007, I saw that in Northampton, Massachusetts, they were having a showing of Blueprint for Truth, the predecessor version of the DVD that we have now.
I think my viewers are actually used to it if they watch it.
So as a result of seeing that, I said, oh my God, you know, because I went to go see this because I wanted to see an architect talk about the structures of the building, because everything I'd seen about the structures of the building was just didn't make any sense. It didn't, because I'd been in those buildings myself, not very often.
Okay.
And so I was just astounded that they could have, that there wasn't a better story for how they were built and how they came apart. And so after the Blueprint for Truth, I started to get much more involved in this. And as a result of that, I ultimately became a petition signer with Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. And then as a result, I held a press conference when we had 1,000 architects and engineers sign on board. And now we're up to about 1,500. After that, I got invited to be on the presenters team because I'm willing to go out in public and talk, and I can do it. So I've given a number of talks, but I've been also on the congressional outreach team. I mean, there's a whole lot of things that I've kind of morphed into trying to...
Wearing many hats,
because I think it's important to get the story out to as many people and try to clarify some of the issues. And in fact... what we're trying to get through congressional outreach is some points of clarification about the engineering study that was done, because as a registered professional engineer, having a fraudulent engineering report is something that I just can't tolerate. Engineering reports are supposed to be cut and dried, pretty boring things, and that doesn't mean that they're content free. They're supposed to tell you what happened.
Is there an American like society of, I know they have mechanical engineer, do they have an American Society of Architects?
Yes, there's the AIAA.
Have they sent out a memo to all the architects in the United States to stop using steel reinforcement and stuff? Because after this day, I was told that previous to this day, never had a steel-framed building collapse due to fire. But yet we have multiple buildings, more than two, collapsing, we're told, because they were structurally weakened, quote, by fire. So I'm wondering, did they send a memo out to all the architects and engineers saying that they should not use steel or maybe a different type of steel, maybe go to aluminum or brass or copper or zinc, some other metal maybe?
Right. Well,
how does that work?
Well, in fact, first of all, I'm not a structural engineer or an architect, but my understanding is that there have been many failures of steel frame buildings.
Okay.
Right? But not steel frame high-rise buildings. If you go, there's a lot of steel frame sheds and other... buildings that are steel frame that don't have any fireproofing on the members. They're not designed for that because it's not a catastrophic loss if the thing goes up and melts, right? But for a steel framed high rise, the specifications are are much more stringent, and there's fireproofing, and there's a lot of other things.
Let alone the quality of steel to be used.
And the quality of steel. A whole lot more goes into those than can we hold a roof up in a snow load.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So, as a result, there have been people have made recommendations, and I'm not familiar with what they are about what should be done. Some of them are things that may have been needed anyways, as far as fire escapes and things like that, although it's unclear what those are. But I really can't address those specific design issues any more than the most general.
I was just wondering, because knowing that, you know, once again, looking at many other times when there were, in history anyway, fires in steel-framed high-rises, many times you'd see fires and fires that would last longer and burn hotter and all that, and
right.
buildings wouldn't turn into powder. And they wouldn't collapse upon themselves, especially
right.
when they had a foundation that was supporting all the weight originally.
Right. And as a matter of fact, there have been tests. One of the more famous ones in the mid-1990s they set up a huge fire intentionally in a steel frame building to see what kind of damage there would be to the fireproofed steel.
Untreated.
What happened was what you would expect. There was a slow deformation of the structures, melting and bending of the beams, but there was no sudden onset of collapse or destruction. You would have seen things kind of sag, that's kind of the history of any of these major fires that you've talked about. If there's any damage at all to the steel, it's a slow deformation. And of course, what you saw in the World Trade Center was everything is looking fine, and then kaboom, all the way collapse, catastrophic, all the way down to the basement.
Just about free fall.
In the case of the Twin Towers, it was about two-thirds of free fall.
Okay.
And there's a whole lot of potential reasons for that. And if it was going to be a gravitational collapse going boom, 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 boom.
Wouldn't I find a stack of, remember the pancake theory?
Well, it would take, of course, they estimate about 90 seconds for it to go collapse. Because you have to do some work as it's going
down. Is it the kinetic energy of the falling object? Okay, and then the structure's got to catch it, support it, and like you said, that would take time because, you know, it would decelerate.
Right. Impacting lower mass. Now, let me just tell you that, I don't know, you went to the World Trade Center, I suppose you went to the bathroom there too, right?
I did, as a matter of fact.
Right. Now, let me tell you, the bathrooms are in the center, aren't they? Right. Now, after the... Remember the stories that there's a pancake collapse, blah, 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 everything goes down? Now, one of the things you can see afterwards is there's what we call the ghost spire, which is the core columns are still standing and there's cross members.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if in the bathroom area where you wash your hands, right, there are still many cross members of steel visible, how can you have a pancake collapse when you've got all this stuff stopping it, right? So... you should have been able to see the stalls and the sink and the basins and things like that on a lot of the floors. And all you do is you see nothing. All you see is the steel, and then it ultimately just collapses.
So my thing, and the reason I wanted the viewers to hear you and stuff, is that would you consider a real investigation, or one that wasn't, I want to say how we could get one happening, an independent investigation?
Right.
What type of investigations have been done to look at, well, anything from Building 1 and 2, let alone Building 7? Who's done the investigations, and do you know anything about them?
Well, I have not researched those particular studies in their entirety. I have looked at portions of them, and I've heard a lot about them. But it's the National Institutes for Standards and Technologies, which is a federal department under the Department of Commerce,
okay.
Right? Which is overseen by the U.S. Senate. We actually hoped to get an investigation into the Senate committee that has oversight over NIST. But it's really difficult to deal with to get Congress to do anything about this type of an investigation.
I understand
right?
that. Yeah.
Right. So NIST has done the reports, and when we try to ask them questions, either directly or through other congressmen, things like that, people like that, trying to get a clarification on a specific point, in a particular thermite. We've asked, there's been a peer-reviewed paper that has identified some peculiar red-gray chips, and those particular red-gray chips are on the banner we have right behind you.